So there's a fair few people in the room who know me. For those of you who don't, my name's Vince, and I'm a lecturer at the School of Mathematics, and I use a fair bit of Python. And I've just flown back with Geraint and Nicoletta, who are sat over there, from Namibia, where we've just finished the third PyCon Namibia. And that's a joint project between quite a few partners, and so and the project is actually coming to an interesting stage. So I'm going to just talk about that and give you a bit of an idea of what it was we've been doing out in Namibia. And it's also been a really nice process for me, because it was nice writing these slides and kind of thinking about where we were 3 years ago and where we've gotten now. This is Namibia. Sorry. This is a map of Namibia. There's South Africa to give you some idea of where we are. And that's Windhoek. That's the capital, smack bang in the middle of the country, which is where we've been going. Here's some stuff from Wikipedia. It's really, really big. It's mainly sand. It doesn't have many people. And at a count from the wiki page, they speak about 20 languages, of which 11 are officially recognized and the rest are just spoken. So it's a very interesting place, like most countries in Africa. It's fairly unique, and also in some sense because of the way the African continent developed over its history and has basically these artificial boundaries of what makes up Namibia. And on the boundaries, you know, there are tribes that were just cut off and told they're now in different countries. And also you got all these tribes within Namibia itself. But Namibia is a very new country. It's about 20 years old. It gained its independence about 20 years ago, and it's huge. It's a very, very big country. And so when you go to Windhoek, for example, you could be walking, apart from the blazing heat, you could be walking down the street and it feels like you're in Cardiff. But then you can go out to the north of the country where it feels a lot more remote, underdeveloped, and poor. But here's another description of Namibia, which I think should work.
This is a message from the United States of Namibia to President Donald Trump.
Dear Mr. President, this is an introduction video about Nam. No, not Vietnam. Nam, like in Namibia. The best country in Africa. Better than the EU. Way better. The Namibian culture is the best culture in the world, it's true. We have so many tribes, and we mix them all to have the best flavor. Some even call it Nam flavor, it's true, totally amazing. We also know how much you love walls. Guess what? We also have a great wall. It's around our state house, a big wall, even with some gold things on it, okay? And guess what? We made China build it. It's true, so true. This is the Namibian sundowner, the best sundowner in the world, okay? We have the honor to enjoy it every day, while the rest of the world sit in front of their TV. We enjoy them, because we can. It's true. But hey, obviously, we also have TVs here in Africa. We call it Bushman TV. It's only one channel, but it's the best channel in the world, even better than Fox News. No fake news. America has the burgers, but we have something even better, called braai. You'll love it. It's really tasty. Did you know that Namibia is the only country in the world you can show with your hand? How great is that? Yes, you have amazing Trump towers, but hey, we also have a great tower that actually looks like a coffee machine. It's huge, and the best thing is, we let the North Koreans build it. Yes, basically, they build anything we want. True story. We don't know why yet, but I guess we'll find out. We also have a great canyon, the Fish River Canyon, the biggest in the world. So great. Some say the Grand Canyon in your country is bigger. Total losers. It's obviously an alternative fact. We have the biggest. Our music. Oh, where do I start? The best in the world, by far. We just didn't make it internationally yet, because, hey, you would know it best. The music industry is rigged, totally rigged. So, so true. And we do know how much you like cleaning up. Well, Namibia is actually the cleanest country in Africa. It's true. Windhoek won like cleanest city in Africa the last 5 years in a row, I think. Hey, we even make our own beer. We just do it. So amazing. It's actually better than the beer in Germany, because they now have to brew according to new EU regulations. And we still brew the old Rheinheitsgebot style, okay? It's true. On top of that, we also make homemade beer. It's called Tombo. It's so powerful, it can paralyze you the whole long weekend. True story, so amazing. We totally understand it's going to be America first. We're just not sure on which continent you mean. Because in Africa, well, Namibia is first. Wow, how great is that? Two first in the world. The best wishes from Namibia, Oshilinawa.
Right. That gives you a bit of a feel of what it's like out there. That's a joke. But there are struggles in Namibia with poverty. When you go to Windhoek, you don't see it. In another trip, we were lucky enough to drive about 3 hours south. And you're just driving along the road, and on the right-hand side of the road, you see this beautiful, huge, obviously owned by rich people, houses. And on the left, you see shacks made out of corrugated iron. And that discrepancy is very much there. This brings me to the education system in Namibia. So this is what they mean by you can make it out of your fingers, because it's got this strip right here. And actually that's Zimbabwe just there, and that's relevant. What you see here are all the campuses of the University of Namibia. They have more than one university, but the University of Namibia is the main one. I'll probably refer to it as UNAM. So you see two campuses in Windhoek, and otherwise you see campuses all over the place. Some of these campuses are quite big, but some of them are tiny. This campus here, I believe, is basically just a small building. The two campuses in Namibia, I think I'm actually missing one. I think there's three. So there's another campus that is just the engineering campus. There's the medical school, and the main campus. The medical school is particularly relevant. Again, it's a young country, and last year they graduated their first doctors. So this is, you know, they are the whole Namibian government is investing a lot of money in education, and it's everyone is just so motivated to learn out there. And you have people coming to the main campus all the way from up there. So that's, you know, that's two days worth of travel. And the country's doing its best to invest in education to come out of the difficulties that it faces. And that leads me on to the Phoenix Project. So I'll click this in a little bit. But the Phoenix Project is a partnership between Cardiff and UNAM. So Cardiff University and UNAM.
My name is Professor Judith Hall. I'm a professor of anesthetics, intensive care, and pain medicine in Cardiff University. I'm also the lead for a project called the Phoenix Project, which is one of the five major engagement projects which Cardiff University is embarking on. The Phoenix Project is an educational partnership with a higher education institute in sub-Saharan Africa, in line with Wales government's international development policy. Education generally does good, research of course does good, innovation does good, but this is a very direct way of sharing what we can do with others who are perhaps less well off, less privileged than ourselves. It's a very, very direct way of making a difference, helping people help themselves. This is a fantastic opportunity to get it right from the bottom up with the right collaborator. And that collaborator is University of Namibia. and looked for a similar broad-based university in sub-Saharan Africa. The University of Namibia in Windhoek fitted the bill perfectly. We were interested in communications, we're interested in science and science thinking, and we're interested in health. Specifically, we're focusing on women, children, and infectious diseases. That Cardiff University is really good at comms, science, and these areas of health. So we went to talk to the University of Namibia, and they were very, very interested to collaborate in an educational project and grow this together. Communication is one of the three big areas that I want to look at. And of course, Namibia has numerous local languages. Local languages are important to communicate the messages of health, well-being, and education. They are really interested to learn about what we've done with Welsh. It's a language that works. They want to learn about how they can have similar success to use their local languages to communicate health messages to their people. In addition, there is, for instance, no health journalism in Namibia. So one of the things that will fall under the communications bundle of work is starting to teach health journalism and getting perhaps a daily print message in one of the newspapers. So it's been really nice that we can join with the journalism project, one of the other big engagement projects, to promote health journalism. I believe that Cardiff University is a great institute with very much to offer. And I think this is an opportunity to do some good. Why not?
So that's Judith Hall, who's a, I can never say it, anesthesiologist?
Anesthesiologist.
Thank you, UHW. And quite frankly, she's one of the most impressive, inspiring people I've had the joy of meeting. She's a professor, so she teaches, she gets grant funding in, she's built schools in Zambia, and she started this project, which I'm going to be speaking about now. And on top of all that, she also is still in surgery, which just kind of, you know, she's actually doing important stuff, which kind of blows my mind. Let me just kill my email client, because that might make more noise at some point. Cool. The other person. So there she is, sorry. So that's Judith. As I said, she's still in surgery very often. She's been voted like in the top 50 coolest women in Wales as well. And she generally is a very cool person. Like when you hang out with her, she laughs, she jokes, she likes to smile. And she's in charge of this Phoenix Project, which is a partnership between Cardiff University and the University of Namibia. And as she said at the start of the video, the Phoenix Project was going to be a partnership between Cardiff University and a sub-Saharan African university. And at that point, Cardiff looked for an appropriate partner. And Namibia was chosen for various reasons. First of all, that there was a need for a partnership with Cardiff, that we could actually do something useful. Also that it would be a true partnership, so that Cardiff University could learn and gain from the partnership. And I'll talk about that a little bit more towards the end. But also that it was safe. Namibia is ultimately a stable African country. So with regards to taking students out there, with regards to spending time out there, that it was relatively safe. For example, there's generally no malaria in the country. There's some malaria in the north of Namibia. Although when we were out there just now, there was a lot of rain. They don't get much rain. There's a lot of rain. And there was a malaria outbreak in Windhoek, so that made things interesting. Nothing that you can't, obviously, protect yourself against. The other person to mention, he's not here at the moment because he's still in Namibia, is Daniele Procida. And this is him on a Namibian Good Morning News TV show thing. And I don't know how well you can see it, but his band there just says Python software. So Daniele is Python. For those of you who've met Daniele, I don't need to say too much. For those of you who don't know Daniele, he's pretty much as crazy as Judith is. And I mean that in a very fond way. And these two people, Daniele and Judith, met, and Daniele said that a huge potential benefit to Africa is open source software. Africa is being sold the same software that we use commercially in the West. This has a negative impact in that it might not be the software they need. So, for example, Africa are actually miles ahead of us in terms of using their cellular network to do things because they didn't have data networks. And so you can get your medical results via text message. You can do all your banking via text message. And they've been doing this for years. So they're miles ahead of us in that dimension, in that direction. But they don't necessarily have the need for some crazy database system that we could sell them at a high price. But also the problem with that is that if there's not much money in Namibia and they're buying things from outside of Namibia, then that money's leaving the country and leaving the continent. Whereas open source software, if we can build a community of open source developers that can work in Namibia, build software by Africans for Africans, and potentially even work for other companies outside of Africa and vice versa, then there's a huge benefit to be had. And so Judith and Daniele met as the Phoenix Project was just starting. And one of the major projects in the Phoenix Project was building a sustainable Python community in Namibia. At this point, I wasn't in the picture. I was still, ignorance is bliss. I then just about started to meet Daniele. He somehow got me to help him organize DjangoCon Europe with Geraint, even though I hadn't even done the Django tutorial by then. And he's that kind of guy, and he's fantastic. He's a wonderful opportunity. I've actually organized 6 conferences with him somehow. We're completely different. He hates not wearing a tie. I hate wearing a tie. And I think we make a good pair. My wife works in BioSci, and Judith was meeting with her for a research project. And at the end of their meeting, Judith said, I'm going to the mathematics department now to meet a gentleman over there. And my wife said, who, I happen to know someone in maths. And Judith said, oh, you won't know. And eventually they kind of, came to the conclusion that Judith was meeting my wife's husband, which is me. And Judith said, oh, fantastic. I'm about to tell him he's going to Namibia. So Zoe knew that I was going to Namibia before I did because she did indeed. Me, I don't remember the meeting very much. It was kind of a whirlwind and of just me being like, this is all amazing. And then I was booked on a flight to Namibia. They're both as crazy as each other, but both as sincerely and genuinely crazy, which is the kind of thing I think you need for a project like this. And this is the first PyCon. I lie. It's not actually a PyCon. To be a PyCon, you have to be officially recognized by the PyCon Society, and you have to have a whole list of things. We couldn't do that, so the first Python conference was called Python Namibia 2015. And we kind of turned up in Namibia, amazed to see there was this banner, so they knew we were coming, and we delivered a Python conference. Two delegates that hadn't really seen Python before, which was interesting. Here is the Monday. Can you see us at the back? Can you see us? Right? So Daniele introduced what a software conference was, and it was interesting because we had huge buy-in from the university because of the Phoenix Project umbrella. So we had an opening by one of the pro VCs of the university, and it was all very official. Daniele's second session, arguably the most important, what is Python and what to do with it, which was interesting. And then things got very interesting. We had these workshops. This was what was written on paper. And so we had a software installation party, which was going to be great. We were just going to get everyone to open up their laptops, and we were going to install Python on everyone's machine so that they were ready to go the next time. For those who already knew Python or had Python on their machine, they could do a workshop with Daniele. And then for others, we had Jason Rudolph and Faye Shant. I forget his name. Garrett, do you remember his name?
Shay
Fent. Anyway, another gentleman from GitHub who came over. So GitHub supported the conference and to give it an introduction to Git and GitHub. And we were going to finish the day with lightning talks. And that was the plan. And it was a horrible day. It was absolutely horrible. Because do you remember? all I remember is being in this room for like 4 hours, and not realize the state of the Wi-Fi connectivity. The Wi-Fi is good. The Wi-Fi is just as good as anywhere else you go for a conference. But if there's lots of people with a computer, it dies. So it's not like Africa, the internet was bad. It's not at all bad. It was just...
How many people did you have
doing? About 40. About 40, and it fell over. Because also, not all of them had Wi-Fi credentials. So
40 people trying to access the Wi-Fi, all trying to download.
Exactly. But also, not all of them had Wi-Fi credentials. So we had Ethernet plugged in some. Eventually managed to get on a USB stick. That started to propagate and managed to install Python. We were just using the base Python installer. They almost all had Windows machines, so that was causing pain. But I'll come back to that as we go through the years. Daniele was extremely keen to get them on IRC, so we had to find an IRC client that worked. But that was confusing and horrible.
Why did Daniele want to get them on?
He loves IRC, and I think his notion for it was, so now what we should have been doing is putting them on a WhatsApp group, because in fact what we were doing by enforcing them to put them on IRC is exactly what I was saying we shouldn't be doing, using what works in the West and taking it over there. They only use WhatsApp. They have free data on WhatsApp on with their data plans. We shouldn't have been putting them in a single WhatsApp group. It was with good intentions. It was meant to basically say, listen, you can now just speak to anyone in the world. So that was the idea. But it didn't work because the connectivity, installing an IRC client was difficult. Some of them started working through an intro to Python tutorial, but at that stage it was just the worst possible day, because you know, we started with huge enthusiasm, it was going to be great, and then it was basically just 4 hours of waiting, and it was really horrible. It was really horrible. The Tuesday we had a bunch of talks. Please ask more. Yeah, no, it's great.
Was it horrible for you? Or was it horrible for everybody?
I reckon it was horrible for everybody. Okay. It was horrible for us because we had that enthusiasm and was hit by a wall.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was also...
I can understand that it might be horrible for you, because when you have a plan and then it all goes crazy.
Absolutely.
You feel as if you screwed up.
Absolutely.
So the question really is, how did the delegates feel?
Yeah, I think that's why it felt even more horrible for us, because I think we could just tell the delegates were like, what's going on? And they were bored, but they were being told to stay in the room and wait, you know? So no, there was very little positive about that first day. It was very little possible. So please do continue to ask questions. It's great to have a discussion.
Who was forcing him to stay there?
Pardon me?
Who was forcing him to stay there?
Oh, no one's forcing him. No one's forcing him.
So you went to Namibia, you took people hostage. You made them use Python. Made
them use IRC. No, but I mean, I say no one, but actually our first lot of delegates were all students of the computer science department. That was their main delegates were students comparison. So I said, in some sense, they probably did feel forced, but it was just not a positive experience for anybody. Our second day, we had some talks, and this was better. This was better, you know. But if you do look at that, perhaps just from the names, you can tell there are not many Africans there. In fact, we had one gentleman speak generally about software, but he wasn't from Namibia, and it was just us. By us, I mean myself, Jason, and Geraint were from Cardiff University. Tom Daly and Alan Jackson are two people from the Python community in, I believe, the south of England somewhere. That'll do. And Luke, who's a Python programmer for a fantastic company in Holland. So it was good. We were telling them about various things about Python, but if you look there, we were already, Luke's talk was about introduction to automated testing. Geraint's talk was about Q-learning in Python, and we were talking to people who had perhaps even heard of Python for the first time yesterday. Wednesday, more of the same. All the same speakers, a couple of workshops. Actually, these were all workshops, sorry. So for example, we kind of just said, hey, we have these workshops after the talks from yesterday. And if I'm not mistaken, Geraint, no one wanted to look at unsupervised learning. No one wanted to do game theory. People were interested in simulating queues. So Vince, that's me, myself and Geraint went and helped Jason. And it was kind of like, it was a good day. They wrote out in code, but again, it was a bit slow.
Why was it
slow? Same reasons. Just pitching not quite at the right level. On Thursday, we just had this is it. You know, we'll have met for 3 days. We'll talk for 3 days, and it's going to be fantastic. The community will be there. We're going to build an application. We have some presentations, and where do we go next? And that didn't happen because most of the people were at that point working through the Python or the Django tutorial, depending on how far they got. The event, though, did have a lot of support. This was the in-flight magazine on Air Namibia going to Namibia. We didn't know it was there. We were just flicking through it, waiting to be able to turn our laptops on. We're like, we're in the in-flight magazine. That was kind of surreal. This was our spot in our hotel, and this has kind of become a very fond memory for the people in the photo. We used to call it the office, and this conference was one of the most exhausting conferences I've been involved in organizing, because the plan I've just shown you was the final plan. But after every day, we would sit there and work for 4 or 5 hours replanning the next day, because everything. And every day we did it. So on the Monday, we replanned the Tuesday. On the Tuesday, we replanned the Wednesday. And it was exhausting. So this little office is a fond memory, because we all kind of suffered through a lot of hard work there. This is not an Axelrod slide, but that office is where I wrote the first lines of the Axelrod library. For those of you who don't know, I usually only ever talk about that. So I'm not talking about it now. This is a photo of the GitHub workshop. A GitHub workshop took place by the gentleman from GitHub. What was really interesting about the GitHub workshop was that was, to my knowledge, the only GitHub workshop without internet connectivity, because when they gave it, they had to give a GitHub workshop with no internet connectivity. Luckily, they were GitHub developers, so they actually had a working version of the GitHub app on their computers, and so they're just firing that up and showing people how it worked. And so they made it work, you know, they made it work. Here's Geraint over there giving a talk, and this was fantastic. This isn't actually the right picture, so ignore what the code actually is, but Geraint gave one of my favorite lightning talks ever, because Geraint was a speaker at this conference, even though he'd been writing Python for 2 months, something like that, Geraint? And so Geraint had never been to a conference before, is that correct, Geraint? Let alone a software conference. And Geraint wanted to give a lightning talk, because we just needed lightning talk speakers. You know, we're like, we want the local community to give lightning talks, but we need to show them what a lightning talk is, so we just wanted lightning talk speakers. And so Geraint was like, I'm going to give a lightning talk about the Monty Hall problem. And I was like, yeah, fantastic. And he showed me the code he was going to show to demonstrate the dilemma. And I said, that's great. But, you know, you're going to need to explain this a bit better and take your time through it. And he was like, oh, no, I was just going to live code it. And so I was like, you know, you crazy fool, don't say anything. And so I was like, okay, yeah, good idea. And he went up and he gave the most amazing lightning talk ever, because we were all just in silence. Is he going to work? Is he going to have these 5 minutes to get the Monty Hall thing out? And you were off by, like, you ended up having a slight bug because you did random. Yeah, you didn't forget something, a line that you didn't even need, but I insisted you put in or something, right? But that was really, really cool. and a great opportunity for. As we started clapping, you pulled out the other one. It was really great. I've been trying to convince him ever since to do it again, but he's not wanting to. Me talking about it now is actually just a ploy to get more pressure on. But in all seriousness, you know, going back to the benefits of the Phoenix Project, not just for Namibia, but for Cardiff University, it's been a huge benefit for our PhD students who've been involved. A few people came out of the first 2015 conference. This is Jessica. And Jessica was at the time a mathematics student. She was a mathematics student who turned up without a computer. She doesn't come from a very wealthy background. She was in her final year at the time, I think, or maybe she was in the penultimate year. Before going out there, I sent out an email to all our students at Cardiff for laptops. And I was like, oh, what happens if I get 30 laptops? How am I going to take 30 laptops out of there? I got 3, which was probably just about the right number. And we were able to give her a laptop. And it was a horrible thing. It was, you know, basically something that no one else wanted. But it allowed her to code, and that was really, really fantastic. And since, I mean, Alex, you gave your old laptop, which was really well appreciated, this conference, to somebody. But it's not like people are desperate for laptops. Most people do have laptops or computers of some sort, but there are some that don't, which arguably is similar to what you'd have here if you were talking about students. And Jessica was really fantastic. And out of the first PyCon, they started the Python Namibia Society, which is what's on her t-shirt. And she is the chair of the Python Namibia Society. And she's a very, very impressive person who, after finishing her degree, has gone into teaching, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. The other person we got to know is Shingapi, or Gabriel, or as he likes to be called, G. He's one of the coolest people I know. He just walks into a room, he's cool. He was a master's student in the computer science department, and he's now a lecturer there. And those two people, we could kind of see they were people that could be engines for this Python community in Namibia. And that was one of the best things that came out of the first PyCon, was identifying people that would be engines for this community. Which leads us on to PyCon Namibia 2016. This again was a banner that surprised us when we saw it. We didn't know it was going to be there, but they knew we were coming. One of the changes is that this was officially a PyCon. How many people have heard of Django Girls? So Django Girls is a series of workshops that was started by two Polish ladies called Ola and Ola, made it easier. And basically, it's a fantastic initiative that's run workshops all over the world in just like 2 years of being around, and to encourage women into programming. And it's really nice. They come and they dress up the room, it's very colorful, and they have coaches, and people work through probably what is the best Django tutorial. Teaching Django, I don't suggest you use the Django tutorial, I suggest you use the Django Girls tutorial. And actually, it was nice to hear one of the main contributors to the Django documentation also make that recommendation recently. So they had a Django Girls, and that's fantastic. Because it's again recognition of the community, and basically you had 30 people who wrote their first line of code as part of this conference. From the organization point of view, what's really nice about Django Girls is it's just self-contained. There's just people that do it and they organize it. You don't have to worry about anything. This is what the conference looked like. We started off with an installation clinic. We took a bunch of USB sticks out with us. We took about 10 USBs. Sorry? Ten. We had 10 USB sticks out with us, all with Anaconda installed on them, so that just made installing it on Windows machines a million times easier. Do you not remember that?
I remember Anaconda back then.
Yeah, we had Anaconda back then. We also took out a bunch of 40 Raspberry Pis that we were able to get funding for. And the logic with that was that we could then just create our own lab, and we could have our own lab activities, and they worked fantastically. There was a bit of an interesting moment when on Sunday evening, we We were all in the office, in the hotel, in the Laporte, imaging 40 Raspberry Pis. We did a quick back of the envelope calculation based on the amount of machines that we had that could do it, and I think realized if we go full speed, we'll finish at 11, at which point Daniele just suggested going out for dinner in town. I'm like, no, let's finish this. Note that this doesn't say Python for beginners anymore, so it's Python for absolute beginners, we're beginning to learn about different people. Yeah, I even told Sam, we had the conference there. And one of the highlights of the past 3 years in Namibia was something that happened at the conference center. We just turned up, and this happened. Wonderful surprise. At this point, Daniele and I were still doing a lot of the organization, but we were beginning to see some initiative taken by the local community. So, for example, that was put on as a surprise. And it was wonderful. I mean, that was just one of the dancing things. We've got time at the end if people are interested. I've got a second one. That was just really, really special. You'll see there it says Tuesday/Wednesday. I'll explain that in a bit. But these were the talks. We had quite a few people from South Africa come to this conference and speak. So, for example, Llewellyn was from South Africa. Ivan Vosloo was from South Africa. Ibrahim was actually from Ivory Coast. I think it was definitely an
entry. He always sounds Senegalese.
He is Senegal, thank you. I was going to say it was definitely a French person. He's from Senegal, living in Canada. And he was very, very keen. Anna Makarudze is from Zimbabwe, and that's important. I'll come back to that. We had Fernando come over from Brazil. So we had a lot of speakers come to the conference, and a few more African speakers. Again, no Namibians, which was a bit of a shame. But the reason it says Tuesday / Wednesday is because this was the plan on Tuesday. But there were massive student strikes and demonstrations on Tuesday that basically closed the university down. So we were just about to get in our bus to go to the university, and we were told, you're not going to university today, the university is closed. So myself and Daniele threw ourselves on the internet trying to tell all our delegates, you know, don't go to the university, don't go to the university, there's huge demonstrations going on, don't go to the university. We then got a call from Ibrahim saying, I'm at the venue, why is there no one else here? And we're like, no, you shouldn't be at the venue. He's like, no, there's nothing wrong here, there's no big deal. And basically they just fenced off that gate. But we couldn't go there. And again, this is not necessarily anything particular of Africa. A few people said that to us. They were like, you know, it's Africa. And we were like, well, we have student protests, you know, back in Europe as well. So there was nothing really particular about that. And at no point was anyone unsafe. But just as you would in the UK, we couldn't take a bus full of delegates to a place where the student protest. So myself and Daniele were completely thrown as to what we were going to do, because we also didn't know if this was a one-day thing or if our whole conference was finished. IMS is a consultancy company in Namibia, Integrated Management Solutions, I believe. And on that morning, when we were first of all in the hotel just trying to call everyone and let them know to not go to the university, on that morning, the director of that company who came to the conference had already driven to our hotel. He got out, he had a list of other possible venues. The fantastic thing is IMS don't use Python, but he'd come to the conference anyway. And this is a gentleman that just wanted to help. Francois, is his name Francois? Fantastic, fantastic guy. And they were also a sponsor of the conference. And really, their sponsorship is kind of almost second, their financial sponsorship was almost secondary to the effort he put in to help us find another venue. As hard as things are to organize for any conference anywhere in the world, we were able to book venue, catering, and anything else we needed by about midday for another venue. So we were able to completely ship in second gear and reorganize the conference in a couple of hours, which was wonderful. And that's where we had the talks on the Thursday. You see there's a speaker of Simon Cross. He's one of the organizers of PyCon South Africa, talking about Mom Connect, which is talking about how the Python backend speaks to the system of text messages for expectant mothers to get their tests. You also see Lemoni Smith, again, talking about open source in Africa. Aisha Bello, someone from Namibia, who was able to come and give a talk. Barry Sheepers, this is an important one, was our first Namibian speaker at this point, and that was wonderful to have a local speaker. On the Friday, we had some more workshops, and these were well attended. People knew what was going on, and so we're beginning to see a progression, which was fantastic.
Did you get some people who came second year?
Yes. Yeah. Complete hunch, I don't have the numbers. I would suggest about 80% of people who came the first year came the second year. And our numbers went up. We had 60 delegates the first year, we had 18 delegates the second year. And that's all similar that you'd get in any other conference. So. I know they did, and I'll tell you about that now. Because this push was coupled with the computer science department in at UNAM, the University of Namibia, including Python in their curriculum. Here is the line for lightning talks. And any conference in the world would be jealous of the diversity you see in that lineup. Not just in terms of skin color, but also in terms of male to female ratio. So that's a fantastic thing. See, this is Gabriel Shingapi, who I mentioned before, and was an engine of the conference itself. This young man is Sammy. It is Sammy, right?
Samo.
Samo, yeah. Do you remember when I mentioned in the first conference that there were these three workshops and no one cared about Geraint or my suggestion, but we did one on simulating cues? Samo came to that one, and he used Python to for his final year dissertation thing. UNAM have a crazy registration period where you see the longest queues you've ever seen in your life, and he used Python to model that and improve a system with that. But we also are beginning to see more and more people, and this is him giving a lightning talk about that project, and it was just fantastic. I actually read his dissertation. It was really good. It was really, really good. Few other people that came out of PyCon 2016. This is Anna, and she's from Zimbabwe. And we had when PyCon Namibia 2016 got announced, we get lots of people that want to come and need the money. So we have financial assistance that we could offer. And so Anna and Humphrey needed the cash to be able to come over from Zimbabwe. And this puts us in a very difficult position because we don't know if they're going to come or not. But they need the cash before they come. So we gave them some money to be able to come, but not very much. Just enough so that they could afford the 35-hour bus trip from Zimbabwe to Namibia. And that was one of the best things we've done, was to get them over, because they become very, very important people in the rest of the story I'm going to tell. Because they actually organized PyCon Zimbabwe as a result of this. And through the connections they made at PyCon Namibia, actually PyCon Zimbabwe was crowdfunded. Someone made a big announcement in a lightning talk, I think. Was it a lightning talk Helen did? Anyway, at PyCon UK. It was already close to getting over the limit, so it looked like it was going to get funded anyway. But then we got a nice PyCon UK. It got massively, massively funded, which was fantastic. There was one gentleman who he's well known in the community, tried to donate €500 anonymously, but the system didn't quite work, and so everyone found out who he was, and that was actually quite nice, because he did generally try to do it anonymously. But PyCon Zimbabwe was completely, entirely organized by the Zimbabwean Python community, which is fantastic, and a wonderful offset of PyCon Namibia. I'd argue that one of the best outcomes of PyCon Namibia is PyCon Zimbabwe. They got funding, they got support from GitHub, and that support has since grown. Here's a talk, a very brief video of an interview with a member of the PyNAM, so the Python Namibia Society, who was a student at the time at UNAM, talking about the conference and Python itself.
My name is Ngatatwe Mate, and I am a computer science student at the University of Namibia. Most of my time in high school, I would only excel in a subject that was called computer studies. So when I came here, my father told me that there's only one field for you, and it's computer science. I came to computer science at the diploma level. I love the diploma. That's the first thing I can say. The diploma is one of the things that actually introduced us to programming. Second semester, first year, that's when we did Python. Basically, Python is a programming language. But then the thing with Python is that when you compare it to another programming language, Python is easy to understand. As a computer scientist, you know, I never got to learn proper English. So when I came to start learning Python, the English was on a layman's level where I could just pick up what is being said. Most of the time, you get code from the internet that you want to work on or that you want to learn to understand. And basically, that is just code. You can't translate it. You can't do anything with it. You have to read it the way it is. So with Visual Basic, Java, those kind of things, if your level of English is not great, it's very difficult to relate to a code. If someone who doesn't have a background of programming could understand the code itself on the first sight of it, it tells you a lot, because when they start learning the language, they will do incredible things. PyCon Society is actually a society that is solely based around the programming language Python. There aren't many people in the country who are proficient in Python. So we decided to learn the language and learn what the language could do for our country, for our government, for our universities, schools, and everything. What we as PyCon Society decided to do was to take programming and the world of computer science to the schools and show them that this is actually what can be done with a computer. What we noticed was many of our students, many of our teens, they don't really relate to educational applications. So what we did was we tried to take the ones that they actually use and they relate to, like WhatsApp and the new one, WeChat, and we tried to recreate it. Even though it's on a small scale, like a classroom of around about 30 people, and then we give them computers or we try to give them phones or they use their own phones just to try and simulate how the whole application works. And then from that, they can actually get, oh, okay, so this can actually be done by you at your computer. When we have established enough confidence as Python programmers to go out in the industry, to go out in the country, to spread the word about Python, they would be able to come to us as professionals. We wanted to be Python programming professionals.
So that young man's very well spoken, as most of the people in Namibia are. And it was just a fantastic thing that the Python Namibia Society did, was when they all met and formed, they said, right, what are we going to do as a society? What's our directive? And they said, we want to take Python into schools. And they've really done that. And they're really teaching students learners. They call teenage students out there learners. They're really teaching learners how to program, which is fantastic. Which brings us to 2017, which is where we were last week. This photo was taken on the last day. I think there were about 50, 60 people on the last day, but we actually had 99 people buy tickets for the conference. This is the first conference that wasn't sold, wasn't told by the computer science department to their students, you guys have to go to this conference. This was just a conference. And we had tickets that were on sale. They cost about £15 each. The reason for selling the tickets was not to make any money, obviously, because we spent more on that on the first day's food, but just to get some sort of buy-in from people. That $250 Namibian, that £15, was a barrier for some. And we made it very clear to anybody when we were chatting about this conference, that's the cost of the ticket. Cost should not be a barrier. Come and talk to us. And so we did have a few people say, I do really, really want to go, but I can't afford the ticket, and we were able to do that. And it was a great success. It was a really good one. We had a second Django Girls workshop. You can see Nicoletta over there coaching Django Girls. And again, this had about 30 women? 30 women write their first lines of code, and a couple get all the way to building their first web app. This was the opening of the conference. Here's Jessica. I told you about Jessica before. She's the chair of PyNAM. And she's also a school teacher now. And at the opening, she asked the half a dozen or so students from her school that she brought with her to come and speak to everyone. And I thought, whoa, this is putting the students on the spot, because they clearly didn't realize it. I'm like, are they going to be okay to just get up and speak to 90 odd programmers? You should have seen them, the way they were able to speak so eloquently about Python, about programming, about how eager they were to learn from this experience. Please.
What age were they?
Learners, I want to, as a hunch, 14?
I think some of them are high school.
Right, so about 14, 15. But it was just so impressive. I mean, this young lady in particular, the way she spoke was way beyond her years. They are all from a public school, which is arguably important in that they're not from a well. Yeah, I mean public as in not like public here. I mean not private. Yeah, the one where you go to if you don't have money. That always confuses me. The public thing here always confuses me. So yeah, really wonderful. And these kids were there every single day and just eager to speak to you and learn anything. on the Tuesday we started off with workshops. This was a workshop given by a lecturer at UNAM on pandas, scikit learn, that kind of stuff. Geraint and I ran the code doctor / install party / beginner tutorial, and we had seven people, which again, looking at the progression over time, that's fantastic. That's a great number. We want less. Meinolf, again, a member of staff at UNAM, gave a tutorial on web applications with Python. Nicoletta and I gave a workshop on game theory. One of the school children before it started said, do I have to have Pi game installed to go to that? And I told him game theory has nothing to do with video games, and he didn't show up. and Anna, the lady from Zimbabwe, gave a workshop on testing Django. So already we're beginning to see the development of the community there. On Wednesday, the first talk was given by Anna and Humphrey, and they told us all the story of how PyCon Zimbabwe was organized. Anastasia Shepe is a lecturer at the Computer Science Department. She talked about Python as a language for beginners. Gabriel gave a talk about user interfaces for developers. Anna Shilongo spoke again about the Internet Society of Namibia. Ronald, I'll talk about his talk again. Ronald is a gentleman from Zimbabwe who came over with Anna and Humphrey, and he talked about a fantastic project he's doing out there. Christian gave a talk on GIS, and he's a gentleman from South Africa. On Thursday, we again had Ronald speak, and Nashalongo gave a fantastic talk. It was a lovely talk to finish the conference on, because she kind of talked about the challenges. There's this arbitrary target that Namibia will be a knowledge society by 2030. They have the same sort of nonsensical targets that exist all over the world, whatever knowledge society is and whatever it is 2030. But she gave a wonderful talk about the challenges that Namibia faces, in terms of connectivity, in terms of ruralness and things like that. And that was really fantastic. I did not talk about market change. I talked about something else, but I should have copied that back. And again, great opportunity for our PhD students. Nicoletta gave a fantastic talk there. This is Ronald's talk. I tried to get the slide more than Ronald himself. but this was Ronald's talk, and he gave the most amazing talk that, to be honest, it was quite emotional, because he was talking about his work with something called ZimboPy, which is an organization he's set up. It's got a partnership with GitHub, and is generally got members from outside of Zimbabwe working with young girls. And he spoke very candidly about some of the difficulties these young girls face. Zimbabwe has an extremely high child marriage rate, so a lot of young girls as young as 12 getting married as a way of getting funds for their family. Here he was talking about how he's developed ZimboPy to teach these young women to code, but not just to build a blog, but to build things that are also going to improve Zimbabwe. So, for example, here he's talking about one of his projects, which is to build this e-commerce platform. And the way he spoke, so candidly, and Ronald is arguably cooler than Gabriel in terms of how cool he is. Sometimes those two were together, you just couldn't really get too close. Ronald, you know, he's a fun-loving guy and he jokes and he's cool. And at the same time, you know, he's talking about how sometimes when he goes into these communities, he has to stop himself from crying because of the difficulties they face. We had some lightning talks, and these are some of the school learners who gave a talk about a conference, a one-day conference that they are organizing in Namibia, talking about some of the things they can do as computer science and the goal for that little one-day conference. It's a conference for high school children, to buy high school children, and any funds they collect is meant to help them buy computers. So that was really wonderful to hear about. This is the same gentleman you heard in the interview give a talk, a lightning talk about the Pioneer Society and kind of a call to arms for more people to get involved. Here's Jessica finishing, closing the conference and mentioning some of the sponsors. So obviously the Phoenix Project got a big mention because the Phoenix Project does kind of take on a lot of the cost of the conference. But we also saw that's INS again, they sponsored the conference as well. UNAM obviously in time. The Django Software Foundation and the PSF as well also sponsored it. One of the big things about the Phoenix Project is that this is kind of the end of the three-year cycle where the Phoenix Project were officially going to not just sponsor the project, but be the project. And we're arriving at the point of maturity now in the community where we believe that, well, where the Phoenix Project will not just undersign everything and the local community are going to continue to organize these conferences, but apply to the Phoenix Project, because Phoenix Project is not just going to step away. Obviously, we need a slow exit plan to ensure sustainability. But we're kind of looking at this, we're at an important point now where hopefully we can slowly start to step away. Jessica told about the expectation. So more organizers, more Jungle Girls organizers, PyLadies Namibians to start, more PyNAM scholars, Python workshops, and more outreach programs. So, you know, there's plans for the local community. And I mean, investing in someone like Jessica has just been such a wonderful, wonderful success, because she's a very impressive person. This is at the end. They called you know, the organizers up. As you see, Gabriel and Jessica, and this year was wonderful because throughout the conference, this was the first time where Daniele and I weren't running around like headless chickens, desperately trying to figure out what to do next or where we're supposed to go. We felt like guests. We felt like delegates at the conference, which is the point, is the idea. I was still on the Slack channel, still speaking to them, and once or twice we did have to do things with them or show them how to do things. And that might well be the case next year, but I'm very confident that very soon I'll be able to go to Namibia just as a guest. Judith, I mentioned her, and the Phoenix Project obviously are extremely important players here and the work they've done. And to see it not just grow in Namibia, but spread to Zimbabwe. And Anna gave a wonderful talk about Zimbabwe and the PyCon Zimbabwe. And she gave a strong, strong call to arms to all Africans. That, and at one point she said something like, "Do you think the Phoenix Project will be coming here in 40 years' time?" You know, and that was really wonderful. And this talk of the PyCon Africa, and they're coming out to Europe to various other conferences where they're going to be speaking about that. So we're really going to see Python grow in Africa. Python, in a way, is not important. It's open source software that's important here. And that's a message we've always spread. You know, Python's just a language we happen to use, but it's really about open source software, and we're seeing that grow. There are things we could have done better. I'm sure there are many things we could have done better. I wonder if we should have not done a conference 3 years ago. I wonder if we should have done a couple of workshops to some targeted people 3 years ago. But to see how far we've come is wonderful.
How many people did you do with that targeted workshop?
I don't know if it's the right plan or not. I would have suggested maybe a more targeted workshop to 20 people if we could have selected people. Maybe that would be the way to do it. But That's true.
No.
You're completely right. I wonder if targeting faculty, teachers, would have been the way to do it. But
it seems, from what you say, the best response you have is the students. That's it. And the way those students develop, then they're, you know,
You're right. No. I don't know, but so for example, we actually gave a workshop to the mathematics faculty on the Monday before this conference. And that was such a positive experience, where we were going like to solve a particular problem, teach them how to use that instead of using Mathematica, instead of using MATLAB. I wonder. It's hard to tell. Here are some of the wonderful people that you should follow on Twitter. So this is Jessica, this is Gabriel, this is Ronald, this is Zimbo Pi, Pynam Scholars, which is a Twitter account run by these school children out there. The conference itself, PyCon Zimbabwe, and I have horribly forgotten to re-put Anna and Humphrey's Twitter accounts there, but you can get those if you need to. They're wonderful people doing fantastic things. And I can just put this on the background if you have any other questions, which is another one. And that's it. That's everything I have to say. Any questions?
It seems that when you first went out, there's many computer science students. Mm-hmm. The first, what year was it?
I'm not sure. I want to say they were in their final year. I think it was year three. Because Jessica was in year three, right?
Exactly. Because some of them this year were in the fourth year.
Because they didn't know Python, do you know what they were doing? Like, what was their focus instead? And has PyCon and your efforts there maybe changed the syllabus? They included like version control and stuff like that into.
Version control, I don't know. The big emphasis out there in terms of what they want coming out of their computer science department is networking, because obviously they're building, they're building infrastructure. So there's not that much software development as the initial goal. They were learning Java and a bit of C sharp as well, but I do know that as a result, Anastasia, I mentioned very briefly, she's now teaching Python to all the first years, so they are teaching Python. But I don't believe in version control. I'm not sure about that.
Do you know if the demographic of whether it was not just students, has it changed from being more of an academic thing to being like developers and things
definitely. So the first two conferences, it was predominantly students from the university with a small percentage of other people. We had someone who didn't make it last year, his name is Vernon, who he's a tour guide, so he takes people out into the Namibian desert to look at animals or whatever. And as a hobby, he likes to write Python code, and so he was going to the conference. But now that's kind of switched, and so we were seeing a lot more people who were professional software developers coming to the conference. Not a high number of people that were Python software developers, but they were just coming to a software conference, which is fantastic.
Yeah. To sort of get a gauge of things, like how difficult is it, or would it be for someone there to just buy a Raspberry Pi? Like, what's their like purchasing power?
Yeah, it depends. It depends. There's huge discrepancy, of wealth in the country. In general, if you're white in Namibia, you're much richer than if you're black. But at the same time, there is a lot of the non-white population there that, sure, yeah, going and buying Raspberry Pis, not a big deal. They all have computers. They all have new computers. They're walking around with smartphones and things like that. But then there is also a proportion that, they're not going to be able to buy a Raspberry Pi because they have to make sure they can eat next week. So it's a mix. It's a mix. And I wouldn't want to comment on exact numbers because I don't know.
Yeah. In terms of your attendees, what was the percentage of, do you have a lot of people that were trying to sort of come as, to sort of get out of
poverty?
Yeah, yeah.
I would suggest, because we're in Windhoek, which is the capital, and Windhoek's a generally rich area. The poverty in Windhoek is low, is probably the best way to put that. I don't think people are coming with the hope of, finding the next meal kind of thing. That's not what we're talking about there. But there are people that don't necessarily have that many opportunities. A lot of students actually come from very far away places where their family have sold a bunch of cattle for them to go to university. And getting to know people and things like that. For example, I think Jessica is a good example of someone who, as I said, didn't have a computer, but now is not only the chair of PyNAM, not only a successful school teacher that's doing fantastic outreach activities with school children, but she's had the opportunity to come to Cardiff for PyCon UK and give a talk about what she's doing. So, slowly. And I think ultimately the goal of building this open source software community is not necessarily for the people who are these open source developers, but more just trying to slowly build up the idea that Africans can write software for Africans. And on a purely selfish level, I've made great friends.
You feel good about it, right?
Sorry?
You feel good about it, right?
Sure, yeah.
You make good friends, you feel good about what you're doing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, these are great people. I mean, when I stand next to Gabriel and Ronald, I'm all of a sudden way cooler than when I'm not.
you know that if your plan is to become cool, that's not.
there are going to be more PyCon NAs, and there are going to be more PyCon Zimbabwes, and if you're ever thinking of going to a different conference, I'd recommend it. There is a cost, obviously, about flying out there. That does cost, but once you're out there, the cost of things is relatively affordable. So it's
how much does that get?
Depending on when you buy your flight, you might be able to get around £600, possibly more. I ate in a good hotel for a week, and the evening meals at the end of the week came to, I think, about 70 quid. Because you're in Namibia, you eat red meat, and I was eating steak most nights, and it cost 70 quid. So I'm not saying you have to go to Namibia and eat steak, I'm saying it doesn't cost much once you're out there. So, staying in a very nice hotel doesn't cost much. So, if you'd ever like to go to a different conference, I would recommend PyCon Namibia. Or PyCon Zimbabwe, but I've never been there myself.
Okay, let's thank Vince again.